that was actually had been my presidential address to the Society for the Study of Evolution. The title was Strom und Drang and the Evolutionary Synthesis. Strom und Drang refers to a period in 19th century German literature. It means storm and stress. And I would make this as kind of a little joke to myself. But it was in reference to the fact that during the 1980s, there was a great deal of turbulence within the field of evolutionary biology. And in particular, a great deal of challenge to the major principles of evolution that had come out of the evolutionary synthesis, or the modern synthesis, that began about 1930 and continued for about 10 or 15 years. Of course, we think that the evolutionary synthesis synthesized the various fields of study that contribute to understanding evolution. But what I said in this paper was that the synthesis was in some sense more sociological than intellectual, because even during the synthesis and for some time, and periodically after the synthesis, there was really a widespread skepticism of the major conclusions and challenging some of the major claims. Perhaps the most conspicuous challenger in the 1980s was Stephen Jay Gould, who unfortunately died quite young, but was a major figure in many respects, both in terms of presenting evolution to the general public, but also within the field, challenging some aspects of evolutionary biology from the perspective of a paleontologist. He claimed that the synthesis had become hardened around natural selection. In other words, what he said was that the synthesis concluded that the only important factor to explain patterns of evolution was natural selection among individual organisms within populations. He said, furthermore, that the synthesis came to view organisms as what he called unfettered, which is to say unconstrained, billiard balls. By this he gave the analogy that the organism was viewed as a sphere on a table, and on a billiard table. And you could push the sphere in any direction at all, and it would move in that direction. And he said, well, no, organisms cannot respond in any direction. They cannot evolve any characteristic which would be adaptive. Rather, he defended the idea that there are developmental constraints and genetic constraints that limit the possible pathways of adaptation. He emphasized the role of history in evolution, and that the characteristics of particular organisms often could be understood not purely in terms of current adaptation and natural selection, but also required an understanding of their history. He emphasized the role of the structure of organisms and their development in constraining or influencing the possible paths of evolution and perhaps the rates of evolution as well. And in fact, he suggested that there were various tiers of evolutionary change, natural selection not just among individual organisms, but also among species, what came to be called species selection. And in the most extreme, probably the most extreme challenge to traditional evolutionary theory, he argued that evolutionary change consisted largely of a history of speciation events. And so what I would like to talk about today are some challenges to the, shall we say, the orthodox theory that emerged from the modern synthesis. Two of these being challenges that Gould and others posed, and in which I would like to think made some small tentative contributions. And then a third challenge that Gould didn't talk about, but which has surfaced many times and is actually under active discussion at this time, and that is the question of phenotypes as leaders or genes as followers, and this is something I am trying to understand and to come to some conclusion myself. and perhaps you can help me arrive at some decision about this. So the first challenge was this, and this came from, of course, the famous hypothesis by Aldrich and Poole that they call punctuated equilibrium. And this hypothesis was in part stimulated by the observation, which is made by many paleontologists, of what they call stasis. That is to say, many lineages of organisms appear to persist without any evolutionary change for some millions of years. Here is one example of a bivalve, Bonea, which still is living today. There are fossils as old as 17 million years, and they have, to all intents and purposes, exactly the same form. And Gould and Eldridge suggested that this stasis arose from internal genetic constraints, and that these genetic constraints, having to do with the complex interactions among genes, which would make it very difficult for any one gene to change without having, at the same time, compensatory changes elsewhere in the genome. They suggested that this kind of constraint could only be broken occasionally when a population underwent the process of becoming a new species. And so this is their suggested pattern, that you have an ancestral lineage which does not change through time. So this is time, and this is the characteristics of the organism. This is without any change, and then it gives rise to a population which undergoes divergence by the normal processes of genetic variation and natural selection, in large part, and this local population becomes a different biological species. Biological species being reproductively isolated from the ancestral form, which continues as a separate population. And they suggested that only during this this event of the formation of a new species can there be morphological change, which would then be seen in the fossil record. They were inspired by Myers' theory of peripatric speciation, or founder effect speciation. And in fact, they felt that this was the accepted view of speciation, and they felt that they were simply applying this view to the fossil record. So I will remind you what Myers' hypothesis was, which he published in 1954, and which he exemplified with this genus of Martin Pescador, of Kingfisher, found in the island of New Guinea and the small islands nearby. On the island of New Guinea, there is one species which is uniform throughout the entire island, is found in a number of different habitats, but is more or less uniform. But on small peripheral islands, it has quite a different form. It has formed different species on several different islands. And this inspired Meyer to think that new species form most readily when a small group of individuals, representing just a small sample of the genetic variation which is in the ancestral population, a small group of individuals founds a new population. And because it is not a representative sample of all the genes in the parental population, certain alleles are missing, certain other alleles are in higher frequency than the parent population. And he said, these genetic alterations, which are just by sampling error, by genetic drift, these alterations of gene frequencies at certain loci, because those loci interact with other genes, they would initiate genetic changes at other loci, at other genes, to compensate for the first changes. And he suggested that this could set off a chain reaction of more and more genetic change in such a population, which then would become a different species. This hypothesis, which he called founder effect speciation, and which he suggested could give rise to what he called a genetic revolution, this was something that he promulgated in his book, Myers' book, in 1963, Animal Species and Evolution. And I can tell you that this book I came to know better than any other goat that has ever been written. And it was published when I was a young graduate student, which is exactly when Steve Cole was a young graduate student. And he obviously was also influenced in much the same way. And I certainly viewed this as a very plausible idea of how new species would originate. And so I was actually quite sympathetic to punctuated equilibrium when Elkerton Gould proposed it. Population geneticists, on the other hand, were not enthusiastic at all. When they actually began to model speciation using mathematical models, they tried to interpret Meyer's words, and they interpreted it as meaning a mean shift on an adaptive landscape from one stable genetic constitution of high fitness across some unstable intermediate genetic states going to a new stable state. Okay? And then the new species then would have to cross an adaptive valley, a state of lower adaptation in order for natural selection to rebuild its fitness and bring it up to a new adaptive peak. And population geneticists remodeled this, said that this was extremely unlikely. It required very special parameter conditions, and they really, as a consequence, came to completely disparage Meyer's theory, and also, of course, to completely reject the hypothesis of punctuated equilibrium, which was based on Meyer's speciation theory. I should also say, of course, that many people who were not population geneticists looked about them. They looked at geographic variation among populations in the same species. They found many examples of adaptive differences between different populations, which clearly had not required a speciation event. And so they said, obviously, adaptation by natural selection is not frustrated by some genetic restraints. It does not require speciation. And so Gould and Elkerton's idea was completely rejected. Well, as I said, I was somewhat sympathetic to Elkerton Gould's hypothesis, and I thought about it, and in 1987, I published a little note in which I tried to reconcile the observations that they claim are very frequent in the fossil record. And what they claimed was you often see a shift from one stable species morphology to a somewhat different morphology, which they interpreted as a new species. I said, how could might we reconcile the observations they make in the fossil record with the understanding of population geneticists? Is there some reconciliation? And I came up with the following idea, which I still think is a good idea. So that's why I'm telling you about it. The first principle I suggested is that most adaptive novelties, most adaptive changes, are associated with shifts to new ecological conditions, the adaptation to some different resource, for example, or some different microhabitat. And these occur, of course, always at first in a local population, where there is some locally prevalent resource or microhabitat. And so you get local adaptation of the population. Most of these adaptations are going to be polygenic. Usually they will require several different characteristics to coexist.